The next item of business is a debate on motion 12096 in the name of Shona Robison on Budget Scotland number 3 bill at stage 1. I'd be grateful if members who wish to speak in the debate were to press their request to speak buttons, and I call on Shona Robison to speak to and move the motion. Up to 9 minutes, Deputy First Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to open today's stage 1 debate on the 2024-25 Scottish Budget. Last week's committee's debate demonstrated the pivotal role of the Scottish Budget, and I welcomed members' constructive contributions. I'll respond to the Finance and Public Administration Committee's budget report ahead of stage 2. I do expect today we'll hear more about areas where we should spend more, and all members who call for additional spending are welcome, of course, to provide those propositions to me, but they also need to be clear on where funding would be reduced in order to make those funding changes. Before we begin, I also would like to reference the Institute of Fiscal Studies question on how we present the Scottish Budget and its prior year comparisons. The Scottish Government has been consistent in how we compare the new budget with past years. In-year budgets do change and are still in flux, and when we introduce the new budget each year, something that is recognised by the IFS, we're always transparent about this through our budget revision process. I do recognise the interest in this, which is why we published additional information at the end of January to offer comparisons between the most up-to-date current year total and the planned budget for next year. I'm pleased that the report also recognises that, taken together, our planned changes to income tax and the council tax freeze will be progressive. The 2024-25 budget is introduced against a backdrop of a stagnating UK economy that has been seriously damaged by Brexit and a Tory government that is failing to deliver the investment needed in public services and infrastructure. The price Scotland has paid for years of Tory economic mismanagement is plain for everyone to see. A real terms fall in our block grant since 2022-23, with a 10% real terms cut in our capital budget over 5 years. That's around £1.6 billion in total, equivalent to the cost of building a large hospital. The autumn statement prioritised tax cuts over public spending and will result in real terms spending cuts for UK government departments, and astonishingly, real terms cuts from the Tories for NHS England, and not a single penny for the cost of 23-24 pay deals in the coming financial year. Of course.
Douglas Ross.
I'm grateful to the Deputy First Minister for giving way. Can she give her opinion on the views of her former Cabinet colleague and SNP MSP Kate Forbes, who said that continually increasing taxes is counterproductive, it ultimately reduces public revenue? What does she think about those comments?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, of course, as I'm about to go on to say, the additional revenues raised for the Scottish Budget amount to about £1.5 billion of revenues that we have because of the tax decisions that we've made over a number of years that we would not have had we followed UK government Tory tax decisions. That's £1.5 billion that this Parliament would not have the availability to scrutinise and to demand additional spend in other areas would be £1.5 billion worse off. So I think those tax decisions that we have made have added to the revenues available for the budget, and that is important for public services. I want to make some progress, and then I'll let you in later on if I have time. The autumn statement, as I said, prioritised tax cuts over public spending, and that will result in real-term spending cuts for UK government departments. The lack of investment in services in England impacts our funding through Barnett funding arrangements. And that's why the Labour Welsh Finance Minister Rebecca Evans said last month that over the last 13 years, successive UK governments have given us more than a decade of austerity, a botched Brexit, a disastrous mini-budget that almost crashed the economy. Despite our best efforts to shield public services, businesses and the Welsh population from the worst impacts of these policies, each has, individually and collectively, had a significant and lasting impact on Wales. And I agree. As the Tory UK government slides towards the exit at the Westminster election, it seems they are again looking to cut taxes at the expense of services. So I urge the Chancellor on the 6th of March to reverse his real terms cuts to the NHS to fund pay deals and properly invest in our services and infrastructure. Unfortunately, I suspect that we may be disappointed. Just last week... Yes.
John Swinney.
I'm very grateful to the Deputy First Minister for giving way. While the Deputy First Minister is making her representations to the United Kingdom Government on these important questions, will she be mindful that the last advice that we got from the Conservative benches over there was for us to follow the example of Liz Truss and look at the shambles that's created?
Deputy First Minister.
I totally agree with John Swinney, and of course people are suffering the consequences of that in their pockets because of mortgage interest rates and the cost of living hikes that can be largely attributed to that disastrous mini-budget. Just last week, the IMF, they might not like to hear what the IMF has got to say, but I'm going to say it anyway, they warned the UK government against further tax cuts. The IMF calling for it to instead
invest
in public...
Deputy First Minister, it's becoming increasingly difficult to hear the Deputy First Minister. I'd be grateful if members could make sure that each and every one of us can hear clearly. Deputy First Minister.
Last week, the IMF warned the UK government against further tax cuts, calling for it to invest in public services and reduce debt. The Office for Budget Responsibility has also highlighted the lack of detail in these plans, suggesting it would be generous to call them a work of fiction. That's pretty powerful words. Need to see my time. I will if I've got time. We're doing all that we can to mitigate the UK government's damaging policies, but so long as our funding is tied to UK government spending plans, our freedom to take a different path is constrained. Despite this extremely challenging situation, driven by a succession of poor decisions by the UK government, this Scottish budget targets spending where it will have the most impact. Firstly, to help tackle poverty, to support the growth of a green, fair economy, and to protect our vital public services. This government is determined to deliver a better approach for Scotland. We'll use our tax powers in a proportionate way to deliver additional funding for the Scottish budget, funding to support our frontline public services in the face of a real terms reduction in the block grant. The changes we propose to Scottish income tax in this budget are targeted so that we are asking those with the broadest shoulders to pay a little more. This means that in 2024-25, we'll have an estimated £1.5 billion of additional revenues to support Scotland, money that would not be available to support our health and local government services and our social security benefits if we had simply followed UK government tax policies. This is funding our largest single investment of £6.3 billion in social security benefits, £1.1 billion more than we receive from the UK government for social security. This is an investment in Scotland's future, and it takes forward our equality mission, tackling poverty, protecting people from harm. And we estimate that 90,000 fewer children will live in poverty this year as a result of our actions. This includes lifting an estimated 50,000 children out of relative poverty through our Scottish Child Payment. We all rely on local authorities for vital public services, and this budget provides a record £14 billion for local government, including £144 million to fund the council tax freeze. This is a 6% increase on the current year, and as the Accounts Commission has confirmed, our local government revenue funding is now 2.6% higher in real terms than in 2013-14. We're also using this budget to deliver on our mission of opportunity to support our ambition of a fair, green and growing economy. Offshore wind... I will briefly...
The Deputy First Minister must begin to conclude.
I will, in my closing statement, I will. Offshore wind presents the massive opportunities for Scotland, and we're investing nearly £67 million in 2024-25. We're also providing over £307 million to our enterprise agency to support job creation and business growth. And I recognise, of course, the pressures faced by the hospitality sector, and in addition to the freezing of the poundage, we'll provide 100% relief for hospitality businesses in our islands, and we're committed to continuing to work with the sector on longer-term solutions. We heard today that, for the first time, global warming has exceeded 1.5 degrees for a whole year. More than ever, we're reminded of why it's important to tackle the climate emergency for future generations. And that's why this government is committing $4.7 billion in this budget to activities that will have a positive impact on our climate change goals.
I must ask you to conclude
now,
Deputy First
Minister. An investment supported by the revenue from Scotland. So, Presiding Officer, I will come to the other areas in my conclusion, but I urge all members, for the reason that we're putting our investment into frontline services, to support the Budget Bill today, and I move that the Parliament agrees to the general principles of the Budget Scotland No. 3 Bill. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Kenneth Gibson to speak on behalf of the Finance and Public Administration Committee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to be speaking in today's Stage 1 debate on the Scottish Budget 24-25 on behalf of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. I'll highlight some key issues raised in the Committee's report on the Scottish Budget, published on 31st of January. As members are aware, the backdrop to the Budget is particularly challenging. The Deputy First Minister warned in May last year that, and I quote, tough and decisive action must be taken to ensure the sustainability of public finances and that future budgets can be balanced. The Committee understands that significant pressures on Scotland's public finances have presented difficult decisions in relation to taxation and spending. Indeed, the Scottish Fiscal Commission, in its December 2023 forecasts, anticipates slow and fragile growth in GDP and real disposable income per person, with numerous interest rate rises in recent months weighing heavily on householders and businesses, while inflation has stayed higher for longer than expected. While resource funding for the Scottish Government will increase by 0.9% in real terms, largely as a result of an improved income tax net position, capital funding falls by £484 million in 24-25, mainly due to the reduced UK Government capital allocation. According to the SFC, capital funding is expected to fall by 20% in real terms between 23-24 and 28-29, and this at a time when governments should be investing to grow the economy. In a foreword to the Scottish Budget 24-25, the Deputy First Minister said that, and I quote, "In setting this budget, the Scottish Government has adopted a values-based approach focused on our three missions for 2026 of equality, tackling poverty and protecting people from harm, opportunity, a fair, green and growing economy and community, prioritising our public services. During our budget scrutiny, we therefore sought to establish how the Scottish Government ensured that its tax and spending plans align with its three missions. Based on evidence heard, the committee remains to be convinced that Scottish Government spending prioritisation has been carried out in a strategic, coherent and coordinated way. A report highlights some individual decisions that appear to conflict with the three missions, such as the lack of progress with public service reform and cuts to the affordable housing budget, although the reduction in capital availability could only have had an adverse impact, further and higher education and employability. We've therefore recommended that more of an explanation is needed in future years on how the Scottish Government has prioritised and deprioritised its spending and developed its tax plans. On taxation, the committee heard evidence that there remains much uncertainty around behavioural change arising from increased income tax for those earning £75,000 a year or more, not so much about people leaving Scotland or choosing not to come here, but on whether the marginal rate of tax they would pay might deter them from undertaking that extra shift or accepting a promotion. We therefore welcome the analysis being undertaken by HMRC to identify any behavioural trends in labour market participation arising from income tax changes, and we look forward to seeing how this analysis informs SFC forecasts and taxation policy in future. We have also raised with both governments concerns regarding the serious anomalies that exist in how income tax and national insurance policies interact across the UK, which I have raised often over the years. For example, taxpayers earning between £43,663 to £50,270 in Scotland pay the higher rate of national insurance rather than 2%, while those earning between £110,000 to £125,170 will pay a marginal rate of 69.5% tax due to the UK Government's removal of the personal allowance, which Professor Bell told the committee is possibly the highest in any OECD country. We've seen little evidence of either government seeking to avoid or resolve these anomalies, and therefore repeat our calls that they work together to mitigate these issues. The committee has a long-standing interest in improving labour market participation and productivity, reducing economic inactivity and growing the tax base. In our report, we welcome the Scottish Government's plans for a labour market participation plan and ask that it includes proposals to reduce economic inactivity and involves business and further and higher education to ensure skill shortages are addressed now and in the future. In this context, we are unclear, in light of spending cuts to further and higher education, enterprise agencies and employability, how the Scottish Government has prioritised its spending towards supporting the delivery of a fair, green and growing economy as part of its three priority missions. And it would be helpful to receive further detail from the Deputy First Minister on this in a closing speech. The committee again expressed our disappointment at continued reductions in the capital funding quantum available to the Scottish Government, and we urge a change in policy in the UK Spring Budget to enable more investment in infrastructure to enable and stimulate economic growth. We've also asked the Scottish Government for more information on the steps it's taking to lever in private investment through what it's described as, and I quote, the strategic use of its limited capital spend. The Deputy First Minister committed to ensuring that the delayed updated infrastructure pipeline will now be published alongside the Scottish Government's medium-term financial budget. We seek assurances that this will not be subject to any further delay given its importance to Scotland's economy. The evidence heard suggests that the Scottish Government remains focused on plugging short-term funding gaps at the expense of medium and longer-term financial planning. We've highlighted a number of delays in publishing expected documents that would help support the medium and longer-term sustainability of Scotland's finances, with the impression given that the Scottish Government is procrastinating on important decision-making. It's especially disappointing that the Scottish Government did not respond to the strong recommendation set out in a pre-budget report that the Scottish Government produces a full response to the SFC's fiscal sustainability report. This, we note, was a missed opportunity to demonstrate a long-term planning approach and begin addressing the significant challenges ahead. This is a priority and should address issues such as the demographic challenges ahead and how the Scottish Government is ensuring that its social security policies are sustainable and affordable in the long term. Also outstanding was a comparison of the Scottish Government's spending plans with the latest estimates or outturns from the previous year's spend. The Scottish Government agreed to publish this information in January to support transparency and maximise opportunity for scrutiny. We welcome this approach. However, the figures only arrived today, and it's disappointing this data wasn't available in time for committee scrutiny. In our pre-budget report, we set out a series of recommendations aimed at bringing impetus, focus and direction to the Scottish Government's public service reform programme. The Government's recent update to the committee provides some welcome principles and objectives for its reform programme, including recognising the importance of prioritising preventative spend, an area the committee has long supported. However, we've noted few other signs of progress, which is disappointing given the current need for reform. We've asked the Government to look again at our earlier recommendations and publish a financial strategy accompanying its reform programme, which the former Deputy First Minister committed to in March of last year. It's crucial that a coherent reform programme is in place. Otherwise, there's a significant risk that financial producers will, and I quote, drive a series of uncoordinated cuts across the board rather than genuine reform aimed at enhancing the delivery of public services. Finally, I wanted to touch on the SPCB budget proposal for 24-25, which the committee considers and reports on within the context of our budget scrutiny. The Scottish Parliament must have the appropriate funding to be able to scrutinise effectively and hold the Scottish Government to account. The committee also recognised that a high proportion of the SPCB budget goes on staffing, salaries and officeholder costs. Nevertheless, given the significant financial pressures faced by the public sector, we've asked to see more information in future budget bids on how the SPCB makes the most effective use of its funds, including setting out where savings have been identified and how projects have been prioritised, not least in terms of the Scottish Commissioners. Presiding Officer, on behalf of the FPA Committee, we look forward to receiving a response to a wider report on the Scottish Budget 24-25 and to discussing this further with the Deputy First Minister ahead of Stage 2 on 20 February. I also look forward to hearing the rest of the contributions in today's debate. Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I now call on Liz Smith. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you. Now, stage one of any budget process is obviously about political parties setting out their alternative choices for tax and spend, and I'll come to that in just a minute. But can I begin by acknowledging that the backdrop to this budget is exceptionally challenging. Global inflationary effects remain, with resulting impacts on supply chains and energy costs. Labour markets are still unsettled following COVID and Brexit. And as I said in last week's debate, the cuts to the Scottish Government's capital budget, which has just been referenced by Kenny Gibson and several key witnesses at the Finance Committee, including Professor David Bell, have been an issue. There's no doubt about that, and an issue which I hope can be addressed by the Chancellor in due course. The Scottish Fiscal Commission set out its usual very objective analysis, more optimistic about earnings growth and short-run tax revenue income, which has been backed up by several other independent analysts, but still deeply concerned about the extent of the fiscal deficit and the potential for that to grow in the years ahead, given the commitments which the Scottish Government has made to increase health and social care, social security spending. The Fiscal Commission is also concerned about the fact that the Scottish economy has, for many years, been underperforming when it comes to economic growth, because we know that if the Scottish economy had grown at the same rate as the UK economy since 2017, then we would have had around £6 billion more to spend. Maybe just one reason why Audit Scotland today is criticising the Scottish Government about its lack of leadership, which rather undermines the Scottish Government's assertion that everything wrong with the Scottish economy is the fault of Westminster. Yeah. I won't just now. But if these statistics are not stark enough, so too has been the reaction to this Scottish Government's budget. Indeed, I don't think I have ever seen a worse reaction, almost on a daily basis, such as the near universal condemnation of this budget from a vast array of stakeholders. Even some of the SNP's own backbenchers, I'm not sure if they're all here today, but presumably they are now wondering whether they should be supporting this budget. And as Kenny Gibson rightly pointed out, the Finance Committee has had very considerable concerns about the fiscal situation. But let me... I won't, if you don't mind. But let me start with economic growth, because this is the key point, and I have heard several senior ministers say that growth is a priority. If it was, why on earth would you make substantial cuts to the economy portfolio of 8.3% in real terms, when the overall Scottish budget, according to the analyst, has increased by 2.2% in real terms? Indeed, the economy portfolio, alongside rural affairs and transports, is one of the 3 of the 11 portfolios to have real-term cuts. Why would you strip funding to the Scottish Funding Council by £140 million in real terms, when universities and colleges are the very institutions which can promote growth in terms of skills development and retraining and, of course, research? Why would you cut the affordable homes budget, including that in rural areas where workforces are facing the greatest challenges? Why would you cut the employment budget and the enterprise budget in real terms by 24.2% and 16.7% respectively, and the tourism budget by 12.3%, and the Scottish National Investment Bank budget by 29.2%. For us, and I have to say, for a large number, yes, I will in a minute, for a large number of stakeholders who have given very strong quotes about this budget, I simply don't understand that. And will the Cabinet Secretary agree with David Bell when he said that it is not clear at all that this budget has been designed with growth as the primary objective?
Deputy First Minister.
Thank Liz Smith for giving way. And of course, I have made very clear that we have had to prioritise the funding of frontline services because of the real terms cut to our budget. So more money for health, policing, fire, local government. If she's saying that those were the wrong priorities and we should not have made those very difficult decisions that we've had to make, is that where she would take the funding from in order to fund those other priorities? At some point, Liz Smith needs to set out what her alternative priorities are and how they will be funded.
Liz Smith.
Thank you. Just coming to that point, Cabinet Secretary, but yes, we do think that the SNP has made a very serious error of judgment when it comes to the priorities. And can I just repeat again that we are absolutely appalled by the lack of concern that the Scottish Government has towards business, especially when it will not pass on the 75% rates relief on business. Now, the Scottish Government has made a huge amount of its public sector pay awards to support public services. But what it has not done is to live up to its promise that it would return the size of the public sector to pre-pandemic levels. Indeed, since 2016, the Scottish Government's own civil service has grown by just under 11,000 people. And that partly explains why the Finance Committee, on its paragraph 186 of its report, is so concerned about this public sector reform. And it's high time, just as the convener said, it's high time that the Scottish Government recognised the seriousness of our concern. But let me come to tax. SNP ministers have said on more than one occasion that there is a moral argument for middle to higher earners to pay more tax because it allows the Scottish Government to support public services. The trouble is that the public doesn't see that higher tax burden or the so-called social contract with the Scottish Government delivering better services in health or in education, transport, policing, housing. All they see at present is cuts, especially to local government, and an unseemly standoff between central and local government, which is probably why some of them are not going to accept the council tax freeze, because they have simply run out of money. I'm in my last minute, I think, Mr. Swinney. But there is a wider issue here, and that relates to the behavioural change. Flagged up by Professor Graham Roy in his Herald article on the 8th of January and evidenced in recent surveys, plus the effects of the widening tax differentials between Scotland and the rest of the UK, and the resulting Laffer curve effects.
Liz Smith might sit for a second. Mr Swinney, I can hear you shouting down here, and I would be grateful if that were no longer the case. Liz Smith. Can I have Liz Smith's microphone? Thank you.
Can we just come to Kate Forbes's comments? Because she is quite right, and she quite clearly understands the Laffer curve effects. We simply cannot have a tax system which creates disincentives and undermines confidence in the economy, or the sort that the retail consortium is criticising about the proposals for a business surtax. So can I finish, Presiding Officer, on the fact that budgets, of course, are all about choices. I don't doubt that these choices are very tough. But the Scottish Conservatives will put forward our alternative proposals, which includes abolishing the National Care Service Bill, which is not properly costed, not properly set out. And on that basis, we will not be supporting this budget at stage one.
I now call on Michael Mara, up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is a chaotic and incompetent budget, which will leave Scots paying much more and getting much less in return. And it is the result of 17 years of incompetence, of waste and a long-term failure to grow our economy. On 19th December, I told this chamber that it was a budget of unfolding chaos. And 2 months on, that chaos continues and the crisis is reaching a crescendo. Key lifeline services across Scotland still in the dark as to how much money they will have to spend or how savings will be achieved. Our councils, our colleges, our universities, all looking on aghast at government ineptitude of the highest order. We have the preposterous situation where colleges and universities have already received applications for courses in the coming academic year, but have no certainty at all as to whether, come August, they will be able to actually run them. Senior college leaders have told me that the process has never been so confused and chaotic. They have described it as a shambles, as soul-destroying. We are staring into the abyss. It is a struggle to see what the future is. No direction, no leadership, no clarity, no empathy, no solutions, no clue. Not at the moment, sir. Universities not knowing how many places they will actually be able to offer to Scottish students this year when those applications are already in. But why is the budget so especially chaotic this year? Presiding Officer, we do not have to look very far, approximately 5 metres. A weak First Minister and incompetent Finance Secretary leaving a void of leadership at the Cabinet table, with Cabinet Secretaries scrapping over portfolios, briefing the press and spreading disarray. A First Minister who was routed in a by-election and then announced unfunded spending commitments of £1 billion of taxpayers' money that he did not have. The result? This disastrous budget with massive non-strategic cuts across the board. And let's be crystal clear, despite the rhetoric, it does absolutely nothing for economic growth. Economists and academics, the Fraser of Allender Institute, certainly.
Deputy First Minister. Talking
about doing things for economic growth, does he think abandoning the £28 billion a year green investment pledge that the Labour Party have just done today helps economic growth in Scotland or anywhere else in these islands?
Michael Mara.
I would say to the Deputy First Minister that Labour is absolutely committed to making sure that we can deliver projects in Scotland, delivering thousands of jobs and making the transformative change that we need. I have to say that we have to be focused, unlike this government, on delivering outcomes for the people of Scotland. And let's be clear, and if I can say, Presiding Officer,
Mr. Mara.
Let's listen to the Fraser of Allender Institute, perhaps Professor David Bell of the University of Stirling. They have been clear that this is not a budget for growth, and we will all pay the price for that. After 17 years of mismanagement of the public finances, people are paying more and getting less. Labour does not believe that people earning £28,850 have the broadest shoulders, as the Finance Secretary claims they do. And the lesson for... No, thank you, sir. The lesson for the SNP is this. You cannot use tax as a substitute for economic growth, no thank you, to plug the black hole in the finances with tax rises. If Scotland's growth had kept pace with the other UK regions over the past decade, our economy would be £8.5 billion larger, and just think what that could mean for investment in our public services. Scotland needs a government focused on economic growth and getting our public services back on their feet. With Labour, they can have one. And scrutiny of the budget has shown it is entirely unworthy of support from the whole of the Parliament. Our Finance Committee has been damning in its criticism, as set out by the convener just minutes ago, accusing the Scottish Government of procrastinating on important decision-making. In fact, committees from across the Parliament, with members of all parties, many led by SNP MSPs, have lined up to criticise the budget. The Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee reported that the Government's late withdrawal of funds in year had considerably damaged an already fragile confidence within the culture sector. The Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee, damning of the Scottish Government's silo working and a budget process that is difficult to navigate. In last week's debate, the convener of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee cited evidence of the housing emergency, and I quote, "It is an affordability crisis, an accessibility crisis, a crisis for children and a crisis of cost, and all those crises have come together as an emergency." And the Finance Secretary has decimated the housing budget. Committees of this Parliament speaking as one, charities, businesses, trade unions, MSPs from the Government's own benches, nobody has confidence in this budget. We agree. Scottish Labour will not be supporting this budget either. A month of the UK COVID inquiry, the Institute for Fiscal Studies this week, and Audit Scotland this very morning, all laying bare the scale of waste, of cover-up and of sheer incompetence at the very heart of this SNP government. Whether it be the industrial-scale deletion of evidence or budgets with multi-million pound typos, it's the Scottish people who suffer at the hands of this tired, incompetent government, with nearly one in six on NHS waiting lists, crumbling schools and a housing crisis. The Finance Secretary may well be wishing that this was a budget she could delete before bedtime. Presiding Officer, after 17 years, it is abundantly clear that the SNP are out of ideas and it is time for change. Day by day, further beset by crises of their own making, defending a record of failure, only a wholesale change in leadership,
government
and approach will bring the change that Scotland so desperately needs.
Thank you. I now call on Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, let's not beat around the bush. This is a budget that slashes energy efficiency in the middle of a cost of living crisis. It carves a third out of the housing budget in the middle of a housing emergency. It cuts the drugs budget in the middle of a drugs death emergency. Removes £63 million from enterprise, trade and investment when the economy is in desperate need of a kickstart. It starves schools, universities and colleges of funding when our hard-won advantage, our global advantage, is slipping away from us. And it puts a red pen through initiatives that would create green jobs and reduce our emissions. These are the choices the Scottish Government has made, and I can't, and my party cannot, abide any of them. And I'm going to make some progress, Mr. Mason. And we can add the contempt shown for councils to that list as well. As it stands, the Verity House Agreement is now hardly worth the paper it is written on. The European Charter of Local Self-Government is gathering dust on the shelf. And just like many other aspects of tax, there is no vision or long-term strategy from the SNP Green Coalition Government. And that is embodied by Humza Yousaf swinging wildly from a consultation on record council tax hikes to announcing a freeze entirely. COSLA weren't told beforehand. It wasn't signed off by Cabinet. Even the Green Coalition ministers weren't told until moments before he stepped onto that conference stage. Humza Yousaf was deciding tax policy on a whim for the sake of a conference headline. So why should any other party vote for something that even Lorna Slater admits is bad policy? And why, come to that, are the Greens voting for it today when it's clear that councils aren't being properly compensated? What happens if a council decides that this year that it won't cave into the Scottish Government? Will it be penalised by ministers in perpetuity? Because that's what would happen if the cash is, as the government have told COSLA, baked in. Their proportion of the block grant would remain 5% lower than it would otherwise have been year after year. That's how it follows. All of this shows utter contempt for councils, putting them in a bind. The volatility has made it impossible for local authorities to plan their finances. They need certainty to have any chance of safeguarding our libraries, our leisure centres and our roads. And when education is half of what our councils do, I really fear for what all of this could mean for our teachers, our schools and our pupils. Under this SNP government, Scotland has slipped down the international rankings, and the Scottish Government is miles away from closing that poverty-related attainment gap by 2026, because it's only just returned to pre-pandemic levels. Pupil premium cash has also been devalued, and we could and should dedicate entire debates in this chamber to each of the promises made by the SNP at the last election on teacher numbers, stable teacher contracts, class contact time, free school meals, free laptops, refurbished play parks. I am not holding my breath for debates on these in government time. Presiding officer, when Humza Yousaf launched his NHS recovery plan, one in five children were waiting too long for mental health treatment. Since then, things have gotten even worse. And right now, that target is being broken for one in four of our children. Humza Yousaf made a personal promise to clear those waiting lists. And when that was missed, in the very same month he came to power, there was a chance to finally take Scotland's mental health crisis seriously, to put the engines of his government behind it. Instead, he has maintained the pattern of cuts. Last winter, £50 million cut. This winter, £30 million cut is a recipe for more missed targets, more vacancies, more overworked staff, and more scandalous long waits that will be visited on our children. Scotland needs world-class mental health services. Only the Scottish Liberal Democrats have set out plans to treat people quicker, put more professionals close to you in schools and GP practices, and to increase the tax paid by the social media giants to help pay for that, to undo the damage that they are doing. Presiding officer, this is a budget that will also mean more use of petrol cars, more use of oil and gas, and more sewage in our rivers. Green MSPs are deluding themselves if they think otherwise. Because the axe has been taken to woodland planting, to rail services, the Future Transport Fund, the energy transition, energy efficiency, the Carbon Neutral Islands Initiative and Scottish Water. I'll give way to Shirley-Ann Somerville.
I'm grateful to the member to allow me to make this intervention. I'm aware he's not got that much time. I presume he's getting from the long list of things that we should be spending more money on to telling us where he's going to cut the budgets to allow that to happen.
How is Cole Hamilton?
Well, I'm grateful for Shirley-Ann Somerville's intervention. I'll come on to that. I've already talked exactly in terms about how we can fund particularly mental health by tax. It's a realistic proposition to undo the harm the social media giants are doing and pay for much-needed intervention, something your government has neglected time and time again. And we're not talking about small cuts. Just look at the Just Transition Fund, designed to help communities during the necessary shift away from fossil fuels. Three quarters of that is gone. These are cuts that are completely disproportionate in the context of the budget as a whole, and they blow a hole, presiding officer, in what is left of this government's standing on the climate. So I'm surprised the Greens have gone along with this, but maybe I'm not. If the SNP Green ministers want to take credit for the extra funding being invested in pay deals and social security, so too must they take responsibility for the painful cuts. Scottish Liberal Democrats will stand up for a growing and thriving economy, an economy which creates prosperity and lifts people out of poverty, an economy, and I will close on this, presiding officer, which generates the tax revenue we need to invest in lifting up Scottish education, rescuing the NHS and building more warm homes. It is painfully clear that this government is out of touch and out of ideas.
We move to the open debate, and I call on John Mason to be followed by Graham Simpson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Money is clearly tight as we go into the 24-25 budget, and a number of sectors are telling us they need more money, be that local government, affordable housing, the farming sector, public transport, forestry or preventative spending. At the same time, on the income side of the budget, we have the STUC and others asking us to raise more from tax, while hospitality and others want NDR or other taxes cut. So I think we all need to accept that we cannot get all that we would like, and I would also suggest that we should all accept the realities of a balanced budget. Our income has to match our expenditure. Therefore, if we want to spend more, then we need to raise more tax or cut somewhere else. And if we want to cut taxes, then we need to cut expenditure. It's all very well claiming that growing... yes, briefly.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
I thank the member for taking an intervention on that point. Does the member support the tax rises by the Green SNP Council in Glasgow that are set to see disabled people paying 75% more for their care in Glasgow as a result of decisions taken by the council?
John Mason.
Yeah, I don't think that's a tax as such. I'm talking about the general tax rather than a specific charge or whatever. But it's all very well claiming that growing the economy would raise more tax in the longer term. Well, it might or it might not. Traditionally, growing the economy has meant the richest benefit most and the poorer get left behind. So, yes, we want to grow the economy, but how we distribute the income and wealth that we have is a distinct question, and we need to focus on that as well. If we start on the income or taxation side, yes, we do need to take into account what happens across our only land border. Landfill tax probably has to match England's, or we could see waste tourism on a big scale. But on other taxes, we can push the boundaries a bit. A few pence on income tax here or there is not going to lead to massive behavioural change, especially when we consider that house prices in Scotland are generally considerably lower than in London. And there are many other advantages of living here in Scotland, including a better environment, no student fees, and a better NHS. When it comes to property taxes like NDR or council tax, I think we have more room for manoeuvre. Land and buildings cannot be moved. A supermarket in Glasgow is not competing with a supermarket in Birmingham. It is competing with another supermarket nearby in Glasgow. So we do not need to be overly concerned about what England is doing on property taxes. And let's not forget that the UK... And let's not forget that the UK, compared to other European countries, is a relatively low-tax economy, with only some 38% of GDP going to tax and public services, which is much lower than countries like France at 47% or Belgium at 53%. Specifically on NDR, the hospitality sector has been asking for more relief. There have been calls for us to copy England on hospitality and give greater relief to businesses across the board. But in the first place, we need to do what is best for Scotland, not just blindly copy France or England or America or anywhere else. And we also know that some parts of hospitality are doing extremely well and do not need government support. On council tax, there clearly is a debate as to whether a freeze is a good idea or not. £144 million would not solve everyone's problems. On the other hand, we could boost the Scottish Child Payment or the housing budget. Against that, some council taxpayers are under real financial pressure and will appreciate this kind of relief. There is not a clear right and wrong answer to this. At this point, can I just mention comparisons to previous year's figures? There is no single right answer to this. Should we compare last year's approved budget or last year's estimated outturn? My answer to that is we should compare with both if we're being transparent. There is no right answer. Both are correct. On the expenditure side, I think we do have to celebrate the tremendous increase for social security from £5 to £6 billion. This is exceptional in this year's budget and I think shows where the Scottish Government's priorities and the SNP's priorities lie. targeting money at two groups who need it most, namely families in poverty and people with disabilities. Surely that has to be the right thing to do. Other areas of expenditure are less favourable, and one particular topic has been the reduction to the budget for affordable housing. Many in the third sector and beyond are concerned about this, and I would have to accept I am concerned about it as well. And I welcome the Deputy First Minister's commitment to send any extra funding that way. Housing is clearly part of a capital budget, and I would just make the following points on that. Firstly, Westminster decides the vast majority of the capital budget, and the UK as a whole would be doing better if Westminster invested more in housing and other capital projects. And secondly, however, even if Westminster does not want to spend on capital, they could have relaxed Scotland's borrowing ability for this. Instead, they have imposed an incredibly tight fiscal framework, which takes no account of higher inflation in recent years for steel, concrete and many other components of construction projects. Finally, if I could touch on public service reform, which has been a continuing theme for the Finance Committee, I'm interested by the question of how much we spend on administration as a proportion of delivering actual frontline services. For example, last week at the Social Justice Committee, Social Security Scotland told us that their admin costs are about 5.2% of benefits paid out, whereas for the equivalent benefits in England, the DWP is paying something like 6.3%. So that is good. Again, at the Finance Committee this week, we looked at the financial memorandum for the Agriculture and Rural Communities Bill. This is a replacement for the Common Agricultural Policy, and they are looking at admin costs of about 11%. Now, I'm not saying that social security and agricultural payments are directly comparable, but it does seem to me that we need to look at administrative costs. And, of course, that links into the question of commissioners, which we've already mentioned. So, overall, we do face a difficult task in setting the 24-25 budget. I believe we need to target actual frontline services, and we are right to target where the needs are greatest. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Graeme Simpson to be followed by Michelle Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I don't need to bother with any scene setting here because Liz Smith has already done an excellent job at that. But I will agree with her that the Scottish budget has gone up, though a lower capital allocation is regrettable. I can also agree that, in the words of the IFS, Scottish budget documentation gives a, quote, misleading impression of the funding available for the health service, councils and many other services. They found that by omitting top-ups such as wage rises, spending on the health service would be cut by 0.7% in real terms, while the budget states there would be a 1.3% year-on-year increase. So Neil Gray must be delighted about that. Now let me get straight. I will.
Deputy First Minister.
Does Graeme Simpson recognise the irony when the UK Tory government cut in real terms the NHS budget in England and all we got was £10.8 million for the health service, and we have put in the additional money to create that real terms increase? Is he not embarrassed trying to make a point when his own government has cut the NHS budget in England in real terms?
I would be embarrassed if I was the finance secretary, because she has not said that she disagrees with any of what I just said. So there's a real terms cut to the health budget. So let me get straight to it by talking about my own portfolio, then I'll touch on others. Last week, Mairi McCallan was quizzed about the cuts to her own budget, which she admitted were challenging. And if I were her, I would have been furious, given that if we are to grow as a nation, then we need to invest in transport, net zero and just transition, just as Neil Gray should have been angry at the cuts to his wellbeing economy, fair work and energy portfolio. But Ms McCallan didn't give me the impression of being furious when she appeared at the Net Zero Committee. I asked her about cuts to the capital budget of SPT. Now, I say cuts, Presiding Officer, it's been obliterated to nothing, and that has consequences. Things like the Glasgow subway modernisation will be affected. Projects like the East Kilbride rail enhancement will be hit through funding cuts to the park and ride element of that. The Lanark Transport Interchange will see a financial black hole. Mairi McCallan says SPT should use reserves, but that shows a lack of understanding about SPT's budget. reserves are accounted for. This budget will impact on our ability to improve public transport and get people onto it and out of their cars. There are other examples of this. The Bus Partnership Fund is being cut, again, to zero. That's the fund that pays for infrastructure, allowing buses to move around easier and quicker. This is a government that says it wants to cut the amount we travel in cars. Well, you could have fooled me. The Scottish Government has cut the total rail services budget by £79.9 million in cash terms. It's cut the Future Transport Fund by over 60% in cash terms. It's cut the total ferry services budget by £5.5 million in cash terms. It's cut the total active travel low carbon budget by £40.8 million in cash terms. They were meant to be spending £320 million on active travel. It's now £100 million short of that. And you would think Patrick Harvey might resign over that, but he hasn't. Now let me turn to local government. All councils, as they do every year under the SNP, are making cuts. Those in my own patch are shielded to some degree by the booming Strathclyde Pension Fund asking for less contributions. However, anyone claiming that the government is putting in enough money to cover what's needed to freeze council tax is wrong. Services will be hit and things will close. Cosler argued that a fully funded freeze would require the Scottish Government to provide funding of £300 million, and that's £156 million more than is being offered. What's to stop any council increasing council tax? The threat of removing funding. And I've heard that if one breaks ranks, they will all be punished. So much for a new era of respect for our councils from local government. And going back to transport, if councils don't get the funding they need, the potholes get worse. It's becoming a lottery as to whether you'll make it to your destination if you drive in places like Edinburgh or Glasgow. Housing is also taking a hit. This is the second year in a row the Affordable Homes Supply Programme budget has been reduced. So we can kiss goodbye to any hope of hitting the government's overambitious affordable homes target. I'm just about to close. Presiding officer, my good friend.
Members, let's hear one another. Mr. Simpson.
Yes, exactly. We should treat each other with respect. Presiding officer, my good friend Joe Fagan, Joe's the Labour leader of South Lanarkshire Council, called the budget incoherent and inadequate, and the worst Scottish budget in the 25-year history of the Scottish Parliament. That is saying something, but he's right.
Thank you, and I call Michelle Thompson to be followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Budgets are about choices. This year, for completely understandable reasons, certain budget pots, such as health, have been afforded more protection than others. The price we pay is less support over the next year for business. I would be concerned if this was to become a trend, but would note if we're serious about more positive health outcomes, then we need more well-paid jobs. And indeed, Public Health Scotland themselves state this in their website, and multiple long-term studies have proven this causal relationship. So this means we have to have a balanced approach towards funding decisions. Similarly, there's a presently perfectly justifiable focus on making positive social security choices. However, the Scottish Fiscal Commission estimates that spending in this policy area in 24-25 will exceed the block grant adjustment by more than £1 billion. So I note again, a really positive impact on absolute and relative poverty in the long run will only be achieved if we significantly grow the number of well-paid jobs in the economy. Now, I make these points to emphasise that to serve both the health and the economic security of the Scottish people, we need a longer-term balance and strategic consideration of the budgetary process. For this reason, I personally agree with the call made by multiple agencies and the Scottish Fiscal Commission for a multi-year approach. My second substantive point is regarding uncertainty. As Nobel Prize-winning Professor Deirdre McCloskey put it, and I quote, "The economy, like science or art, is more like an organism growing uncertainly towards the light than a steel machine repeating exactly today and tomorrow what it did yesterday." So we need to avoid thinking we know precisely what the future will bring. Our assumptions, such as they are, must use the best evidence available. We must remain curious in the face of uncertainty and plan as best we can. And in this context, I note this morning's letter from the FPA committee to the Scottish Government on the approach being taken to the National Care Service Bill and its accompanying financial memorandum. I recognise the considerable work that's been done to address some of the concerns by the committee, but I note that the longer timescales for delivery lead to considerably more uncertainty over funding, evolving assumptions and ultimate delivery. There is, of course, a broader context here, and one that is too often not considered by some MPs. I have put on the record before that I regret that the narrowness of devolution leads to a narrowness of thought. I've spoken often about the fundamental characteristics of the UK economy, which affects budgets at both the UK and Scotland levels. So I was therefore particularly interested in part of this month's report of the Bank of England's Monetary Policy Committee, which includes an analysis of UK economic performance. Now, economic growth reflects a combination of labour supply and productivity. Prior to 2007, if you recall, a Labour government were in power at that time, the major component of UK economic growth was productivity growth. However, the bank's analysis shows that it came to a shuddering halt in 2007 and has never recovered, basically because of a failure of overall investment and a collapse in total factor productivity, which speaks to a failure to create effective conditions for an innovation-driven economy. And what growth there has been at the UK level since 2010, when the Tories came back into power, has largely been from increased labour supply due to population growth. And we know that Scotland is vulnerable in this respect due to our demographic challenges. Little wonder, then, that Professor St Anton Muscatelli's commented that we need to reboot productivity growth. And he goes on to say this will involve the need to address skilled labour shortages through skilled immigration, a critical issue that's not been addressed by the straitjacket of the Tory Brexiteers with the same mood music from the born-again Brexiteers in the Labour Party. So if we're to reboot our economy and have a secure basis for funding the many desirable priorities we have, it's extraordinarily difficult to achieve in Scotland under the current constraints of devolution. We lack the necessary borrowing powers to tackle underinvestment. Yes, of course.
Michael Mara.
I appreciate the member giving way. Does she not recognise that building a skilled labour base requires investment in our colleges and our universities? The university sector is declining performance in comparison to the rest of the UK, and the level of cuts this government is imposing on them is actually cutting to the core of our argument, and meaning that we're not providing the skilled labour force we need.
I think he makes a fair point, and I personally would always want to see more investment in that arena because we're in a highly competitive marketplace. But the point I'm making is around the wider UK economy and reminding everyone in here that we live within that straitjacket, specifically about productivity and our inability to control immigration. And I look forward to him commenting on that in further remarks. To finish off, we lack the necessary borrowing powers to tackle underinvestment, to partner and encourage private sector investment at scale. And critically, we lack the necessary policy powers to encourage skilled immigration. It's not sustainable. So the last thing, Presiding Officer, one of the things we can do to set a more positive culture, as the economic historian Joel Mocker put it, economic change in all periods depends, more than most economists think, on what people believe. We need to be more supportive of the innovators and the entrepreneurs and more focused on the development of excellence in our skills system. Frankly, we need a revolution in attitudes to match a revolution in investment and labour supply issues. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Pam Duncan-Glancy to be followed by Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This SNP Green budget is not just bad news for the people of Glasgow, it's bad news for the very fabric of our society, our education system and our collective futures. COSLA has said that it is not sufficient to keep current services running. Because for years now, council budgets have been cut to the bone as the SNP and Greens have compounded Tory austerity and siphoned money away from essential services. Their financial mismanagement has left councils having to make brutal decisions just to make ends meet. Now their latest policy by press release, the freeze on council tax, a tax they promised to abolish long ago, has made it worse. Almost everything that can be stopped, stripped back or cut already has been. The only decisions left to take are the impossible ones. Savings that councils have taken off the table in years past because of the impact their loss will have on local people are back on the table. It is no longer about just stripping back. It's a choice between which essential service can be scrapped. In Glasgow, it's disabled people and the poorest people in our communities paying the price. And the approach of the SNP-run council is just as chaotic as the SNP government, and non-strategic as their colleagues here in government are towards this budget. Because not only are disabled people paying the price, they're doing it via a charge their party committed to scrapping. Far from getting rid of non-residential care charges, disabled people in Glasgow are facing eye-watering increases of up to 75% for their care. In many cases, that means more than three quarters of their income from benefits is eaten up. And they're left wondering why, once again, the target is on their back. They do not have the broadest shoulders. That is the choice by the SNP and Greens at both levels of government facing people in Glasgow. And, Presiding Officer, when the going gets tough, it is always disabled people's support that has to get going. The proposed eradication of the capital budget of SPT is alarming for many reasons, as we've heard, but particularly as it could put critical modernisation projects like making the Glasgow subway accessible in jeopardy, which is why I agree with the SNP leader of SPT, who wrote in a letter to the First Minister, "It's an unacceptable position put forward without consultation and simply cannot be permitted to happen." Presiding Officer, the consequences of this budget on our constituents is devastating, and education isn't safe either. As council budgets are cut to the bone, our schools are being stretched thin, being forced to do more with less. The Cabinet Secretary for Education doesn't seem to grasp the gravity of the situation, which makes things worse. During her appearance at committee, she spent the same money over and over again, handing local authorities more demands with one hand and taking their money away with the other. It's little wonder the SNP is failing to make progress on closing the attainment gap when it's leaving local authorities with little choice but to use attainment funding to plug holes in the education budget. Presiding Officer, schools are struggling to keep the lights on and the doors open, never mind tackle the challenges of violence and behaviour in school, trying to support the increasing numbers of pupils with additional support needs, while resource and staff has failed to keep pace or deal with RAC. That the Cabinet Secretary's answer is that she reserves the right to claw back £140 million allocated to maintain teacher numbers, when some councils may have had to decide it's additional resources in other areas of education they need, like support staff, shows just the lack of strategy or planning in this government's budget. Does the Cabinet Secretary really think it's fair to deny councils the flexibility when she's voting for a budget that leaves them with barely two pence to rub together? Presiding Officer, it's not just schools suffering too either. Our colleges and universities have been hammered with cuts of at least £100 million. Beyond the clear-cut reductions in this year's budget, the cumulative impact of years of stagnation in the sector is clear for all to see. This year's universities will get 19% less per student than they did in 2013, forcing them to cross-subsidise from a whole variety of places, including plugging gaps with high fees for international students. Meanwhile, colleges are facing a reduction equivalent to 8.4% of their day-to-day spend, with a maintenance backlog of £321 million and huge pressures already on course and staff budgets. It's no wonder the head of Colleges Scotland has warned that this year's budget will force colleges to make inescapably hard choices. I attended Kelvin College graduation service yesterday, an outstanding college nourishing talent and delivering the skilled workforce of the future, despite the challenges. Students, staff and families alike were joyous in the celebration of their achievements. They deserve better than a government that fails to prioritise their future. Year on year, budget movements in year, such as clawing back the promised £46 million for further and higher education, has left the sector on edge. How can we expect the sector, unions and employers to resolve disputes in our institutions, plan for the future, when they can't trust the government when they're negotiating them with them? Presiding Officer, I agree with the President of NUS, who pointed out that if the government's priority was ever education, then they do have a funny way of showing it. But change is coming, because like pupils, students, staff across the sector, Scottish Labour knows education is an investment in our collective prosperity. It holds the key to unlocking opportunity, unleashing potential and building a brighter tomorrow for generations to come. So it's time to reject this anti-council, anti-community, anti-opportunity budget and say enough is enough. The change Scotland needs is not more chaos and no plan. It's a government that values communities, values education and values opportunity. That, Presiding Officer, that government is a Labour government and the people of Scotland know it.
Thank you, Ms Duncan Glancy. I now call Kevin Stewart to be followed by Ross Grier. Mr Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And let's look at the hand that Scotland has been dealt. Every family in Scotland has been feeling the impact of inflation since the Westminster government drove a nail into the coffin of an already precarious UK economy with a disastrous Liz Truss budget. Yeah. Scottish public services are feeling the exact same squeeze as family budgets, and what did Westminster do? It delivered an inflation-adjusted cut to Scotland's block grant. Not a rise to protect public services, a cut. And it didn't need to be that way. Richard Hughes, the chairman of the Office of Budget Responsibility, the UK government's very own bookkeeper, spoke here in this building and said that the Chancellor opted to cut two taxes in his autumn statement rather than to try to protect the real spending power of public services. Though, I'll give way to Mr Fraser.
Martin Fraser.
Well, for Mr Stewart giving way, eventually. I wonder why he and his SNP colleagues never recognised the point that the Barnett formula delivers an additional £2,000 for every man, woman and child in Scotland to spend on public services above the UK average. The same Barnett formula that Mr Stewart and his colleagues would scrap tomorrow. Why didn't he recognise that point?
That was a speech rather than an intervention. What I would say to Mr Fraser is that we have an inflation-adjusted cut to our revenue budget, to our block grant, and a 10% cut to our capital budget. That has a major impact on the people of Scotland. Those are Tory cuts that we have to bear. Austerity is a choice. It is Westminster's choice. And that's what the Scottish Government has been dealing with year after year. Tory Westminster austerity. And Tory austerity piled on top of Tory austerity, and all we have to look forward to is Labour austerity from Sir Keir Starmer. Hardly a day goes by without Labour promising to outdo the Tories, whether that's tax cuts for the wealthy, giving bankers free rein with bonuses, or cutting their £28 billion green transition pledge. And who knows what they will renege on tomorrow. But through it all, this Scottish Government has delivered for the people of Scotland. Yes, taxes are more progressive in Scotland, but let's look at what we get for that. I'll take Mr Hoy's intervention if he wants, Presiding Officer, rather than him shouting.
OK, on that basis, he was talking about taxes for the wealthy. Does he believe that those earning £28,000, for example, nurses and teachers, are they the kind of wealthy people he wants to tax more?
Kevin Stewart.
Progressive taxation, Presiding Officer. And what I would say is the very people that Mr Hoy mentions are paid much more in Scotland thanks to this SNP government. We have delivered for the people of Scotland. And yes, taxes are more progressive here, but let's look what we get for that. Free prescriptions here in Scotland, £9.65 under the Tories in England. The freedom to drive your car down any public road for free in Scotland, £7.60 for toll roads under Tories in England. Free university tuition fees in Scotland, a £27,000 millstone around the necks of young people in Labour Wales, and £27,950 in Tory England. A free bus pass when you reach 60, but you'll wait until you get your pension in Tory England, and they keep putting the age of that up as well. And the list of benefits that folk get here in Scotland goes on. the baby box, 1,140 hours of free childcare for 3- and 4-year-olds, as well as eligible 2-year-olds, free bus travel for under-22s, free dental care until the age of 26. In England, you can't even get a dentist. 7 additional welfare payments from Social Security Scotland, including the Scottish Child Payment, publicly owned rail services. And it doesn't stop there. We spend more on education, more on transport, more on police, more on housing, more on agriculture and fishing, more on economic development, and more on the environment. And that extra spending, Presiding Officer, is why we have more police officers, more prison staff, more firefighters, more nurses, more GPs, more consultants, and more dentists. And it is why accident and emergency departments in our hospitals are so much better than the rest of the UK. The North East is benefiting from the Scottish Government's £500 million Just Transition Fund. Westminster has refused to match this, even though the UK Treasury has benefited from hundreds of billions of oil money that has flowed from the North East of Scotland to London. Another Westminster rip-off. This is a tough budget, but one that reflects our shared values as a nation, where we are committed to tackling poverty and trying to protect people from the harm caused by Westminster austerity. However, we cannot mitigate every horror handed down by Westminster, and while the Scottish Government does its best with the powers that we have, what is required is for this place to hold all of the levers of power. It is time for Scotland. It is time to get out of broken Brexit Britain. It's time for independence.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. I now call Ross Greer to be followed by Brian Hodel. Mr. Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a number of members have already mentioned, there has never been a more difficult context for setting a Scottish budget. We went into this process with a gap of £1.5 billion to fill. As the convener of the Finance Committee pointed out at the start of this debate, the capital cuts, the cuts to our capital budget, are 20% according to the figures used by the Scottish Fiscal Commission. And on top of that, we're having to do this in a process that is deeply dysfunctional, a mad dash between an increasingly late UK government autumn statement to the publication of a Scottish Government budget, which is expected before Christmas, and yet we still don't know what decisions the UK government will make in March of this year when they publish their budget, and it could all change again. Budgets should reflect priorities. They should make a government's values clear, and that's the first line of the Deputy First Minister's foreword to this budget document. And the Scottish Government's priorities are equality, opportunity and community. I've mentioned before, I think that we are potentially too broad in those and that there's some focus that's needed. But I think in the circumstances of this budget, there is a clear reflection of green values. This is a budget that puts people and planet first. And the contrast this week couldn't be sharper. We've seen reports confirming that this planet has hit the catastrophic threshold of 1.5 degrees of global warming. But we have a UK government ditching climate action and approving more oil and gas licences. And a Labour opposition, just in a moment, thank you. We have a Labour opposition ditching their £28 billion spending commitment on climate, which wasn't even enough in the first place. Compare that to the £4.7 billion in this Scottish Government budget for next year alone for climate and nature. That is securing Scotland's future and our planet's future. We are taking action now to tackle the climate crisis and to restore our natural world, and we are creating jobs for the future. I'll take Liz Smith's intervention.
To Mr. Greer, he's a member of the Finance Committee, which has signed up in paragraph 201 that we feel as a committee that the priorities of the Scottish Government set by themselves are not being addressed sufficiently in this budget. Does he agree with that?
Ross Greer.
I'm grateful for the intervention, and that is absolutely what I was referencing in the context of the three Scottish Government missions. I think they're so broad as to create a challenge when it comes to focus, and I am going to single out a couple of specific examples later on. As you would expect, I do have issues with the council tax freeze. But on the point of focusing on the planet, you don't need to take my word for it or my party's planet for it. Francis Azuska, who's the chief executive of Nature Scot, was at the Finance Committee a few weeks ago and said, I quote, I see in the budget a shift towards recognising the long-term challenges of climate change. Presiding officer, I mentioned last week, contrary to what's said about our party, there are lots of things that the Scottish Greens want to see grow. We want more high-quality, lasting jobs in green industries, preferably in Scottish-owned businesses, even more preferably businesses owned by their workers as cooperatives. But we're proud to be part of a government that's delivering that kind of growth. At the end of last year, we saw the Fraser of Allender report showing that in 2021 alone, we went from 27,000 to 42,000 jobs in green energy. And this budget includes £67 million for the offshore wind supply chain, doubling down on one of those key industries. We can't prioritise everything, and I do think the Scottish Government needs to be more focused in its economic priorities and strategy, and that is exactly one of the sectors that we can prioritise with confidence that it will result in a very positive return. I'm proud that green tax policy will mean that in the coming year, there's £1.5 billion of additional spending available that wouldn't otherwise have been the case. I'm proud that we are redistributing wealth in Scotland from those who have the most to those who need it the most. And I am stunned by the Labour Party's hostility to that redistribution of wealth. This year alone, the Scottish Government is lifting 90,000 children out of poverty. This budget will lift more children out of poverty next year. I'll come back to the Labour Party in a moment. I'm sure Mr Johnson will want to respond to that. We have put £1 billion more for social security in this budget. And yes, those on the highest incomes, the top 5%, will be paying more. But good luck to those in opposition parties who are going to go door to door telling the other 95% that you wanted to cut their public services to protect the incomes of those at the very top. We need to be honest. If we want a fairer society, then we need to pay for it. And the opposition have demonstrated again this afternoon, not just fantasy economics, but fantasy mathematics. The numbers just don't add up. I'll take Mr Johnson's intervention at this point.
We'll have to be brief because Mr Greer's time is coming to a close soon.
I'm very grateful that a marginal tax rate for those in the middle of 60%, which is higher than those on 70, 80 or £90,000, is the absolute inverse of progressive taxation.
Ross Greer.
I'm glad Mr Johnson brought that up because for a start, it's not the middle. We know that average household income in Scotland is around the £28,000 mark, which Michael Marrow was referencing as if people on about £28,000 are paying a huge amount more. If you're on £28,000, you are paying pennies more in tax in Scotland, and in return, you get a range of public services that are not available elsewhere in the UK. I accept that we can't put all our eggs in the basket of income tax, though. We can't create new national taxes because of the Scotland Act. That's why this government's delivering a visitor levy, cruise ship levy, carbon emission land tax, doubling council tax on holiday homes, an infrastructure levy, and potentially a public health levy to empower local government. I clearly don't agree, my party doesn't agree with the merits of the council tax freeze, though I am pleased that it is adequately funded. It's not what the Greens would have chosen. We don't believe it can happen again, but I'm certainly not going to be voting down a budget with £4.7 billion for climate and nature and £6 billion for social security because I'm unhappy with one policy. The government has clearly demonstrated its values here. The contrast couldn't be clearer with a dysfunctional Tory government and a Labour opposition who, in the words of Sky News last week, are putting protecting bankers' bonuses ahead of lifting children out of poverty. This is a government, this is a budget that puts people and planet first, and that's why the Greens are proud to vote for it this afternoon.
Thank you, Mr Greer. I now call Brian Whittle to be followed by Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Now, aspiration is a powerful thing. It drives us to do better, to seek out success. It pushes us to do great things and gives us a reason to get back up when we fall. It has helped so many Scots achieve great things in sport and in music and science and technology, business and, yes, even politics. There is no doubt in my mind that it's something we should be fostering and encouraging in Scotland and, with that, creating an environment where that aspiration can flourish. Under the SNP, however, and never more so than in this budget, aspiration, ambition and entrepreneurship have all but disappeared from the SNP Green vocabulary. A strong, dynamic, growing economy is the difference between a thriving nation and a stagnating one. And no economy can hope to thrive without a population who aspire to succeed and a government who wants to help them do it. Throughout this budget, we see examples of cuts to the very things that contribute to the long-term health of the economy. In education, from early years to colleges and universities, engendering aspiration is vital. It's where it's discovered and nurtured. It's where young people are encouraged to find their talents and learn the skills they need to succeed. That resource has been cut by this Scottish Government. And once those young people have completed their education and set out into the working world to advance their careers or even build their own businesses, they need a government to provide support and investment to grow a strong and healthy economy. Scotland does have the tools to do this, from our enterprise agencies to employability and skills schemes to the Scottish National Investment Bank. They have all been cut by the Scottish Government. Presiding Officer, the journey to a successful business often requires owners to leave a secure, well-paid job and take that leap into the unknown world of self-employment. Often they must invest savings or put their house up as collateral. They then have to work all the hours that God gives, employing people, being the last people to get paid at the end of the month. If indeed they do get paid, they strive and they work and they bite, they scratch to make their business succeed. And after years of graft and worry, maybe get to the point where they can start to get the benefit of their risk and bravery. Then they come up against a Scottish Government who vilify them and want to scoop more and more of their hard-earned income to pay for the services the Scottish Government has consistently let down. A Scottish Government who has no understanding of what it takes to create and run a successful business. And where we talk about aspiration and ambition in the context of confident, driven entrepreneurs setting out to make their mark in the universe, for many people their ambition can be smaller, but no less deserving of encouragement and support. For people, for example, suffering with physical or mental health problems, just having the confidence and the ability to go out and achieve something can feel like an impossible hurdle to clear. Community facilities, sports centres, the third sector groups supported by council funding are every bit as critical to supporting these ambitions and aspirations as enterprises to support entrepreneurs. And thanks to the Scottish Government budget, that funding has been cut and these services are disappearing. But it's not just the cuts to this budget that will harm that aspiration. The Scottish Government's decisions on tax are just as unhelpful. And I agree with those who say that the broadest shoulders should carry the greater share of the burden, Deputy Presiding Officer. The difference between us is that I accept the reality that continually adding to that burden to cover for Scottish Government excessive spending and anemic growth is not sustainable. Last year, higher and top-rate earners comprised of less than 12% of the population, but accounted for 65% of the tax revenue. And the addition of the advance rate will see that second number rise even further. And in speaking about behavioural change, we assume this means very high earners leaving the country. But an even greater risk comes from continually squeezing far more moderate earners to the point they no longer have sufficient incentive to try and earn more, stifling business growth, lowering productivity and guaranteeing further years of dismal economic performance. We have already seen the signs, Deputy Presiding Officer, and not just in the private sector. I spoke to Band 7 nurses, paid just enough to end up in the higher rate tax band, who are wondering if working extra shifts is really worth the extra money after tax. How many NHS staff will be thinking something similar, and how many much more pressure will that put on NHS boards already struggling to recruit? And what does it say to business owners and entrepreneurs who work incredibly hard, often taking big financial risks, when the government keeps piling on the pressure with higher taxes while making it harder to help to grow? This is before we even mention those operating in the retail, hospitality and leisure sector, who the Scottish Government seem intent on leaving at a disadvantage to their competitors elsewhere in the UK. There is no question in my mind Scotland needs to increase its tax take. But while the SNP and Greens are going for the quick fix of squeezing more and more out of a relatively small pool of workers, despite the risks of diminishing returns, I believe the only way to sustainably increase revenues is to have more people earning more. To do that, we need a government and a budget that has its eyes on the horizon, not in the opinion polls. A government that thinks and plans for the long term, giving everyone a path upward, not one that cuts off the lowest rungs of the ladder for short-term savings. Which brings me back in closing, Deputy Presiding Officer, to aspiration. Whether it's starting a new business, changing careers or taking a small step on the path towards better mental health, it's aspiration that drives us to make that leap and take that risk. But the SNP are making that leap wider, the risk greater, and leaving more and more people asking, why bother? Aspiration is still alive in Scotland, Deputy Presiding Officer, but with this government and this budget, it's left on life support.
Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Whittle. I now call Mark Griffin to be followed by Stuart McMillan. Mr Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I draw members' attention to my register of interest, which shows that I was an owner of a private rented property in the North Lanarkshire Council area up until July last year. This has been a chaotic budget from a government now devoid of any economic strategy, actively planning to send a housing emergency spiralling. Not only will working people pay more and get less, but the 10,000 children trapped in temporary accommodation will continue to suffer that misery. It's a budget that started with a raid on people in council tax bands E to H and ended up with an unfunded council tax freeze. But it's the £200 million cut from affordable house building which has united all corners of the housing sector, private, public and voluntary, in anger and complete disbelief. Shelter says that it has lost confidence the government can deliver its plans. Homes for Scotland say it threatens Scotland's social wellbeing. SFHA and JRF simply describe it as brutal. This is a budget which will make poverty worse and intensify Scotland's spiralling housing emergency.
I'm grateful for the intervention, and I wouldn't pretend, I don't think anybody in the Greens or the SNP would pretend that the affordable housing budget is in a good situation, but it's already been mentioned that we're facing a £485 million overall cut to the capital budget. So I'd be interested in, and this is a sincere question, what would the Labour Party reallocate? Because I think if we can reallocate from elsewhere in the capital budget into affordable housing, we should. I've just not heard any proposals from the Labour Party yet.
Mark Griffin.
The capital budget has been cut, I acknowledge that, but I fail to understand why that capital cut has been multiplied by six times and then handed to the housing budget. Now, I think it's a reasonable ask to say where money should be allocated to fund priorities, but I don't understand why the government are asking opposition benches on how they fund their promises. It was the government's promise. It's the government's promise to deliver 110,000 houses. And it's a bit rich to ask the opposition on how to find the money to fund them.
And members, we listen to the member who has the floor. Mr Griffin.
The Finance Secretary called this a values-led budget. Those values now include increasing homelessness. That's not my words, but the absolutely damning verdict of Shelter Scotland. I'll give way to Mr Dorris.
Bob Dorris.
Mr Griffin said it was government's responsible to find the commitment for 110,000 new affordable homes and not the opposition's. Does that mean Labour don't support those new affordable homes?
Mark Griffin.
We absolutely support them. We'll bring forward our spending plans when it comes to the next manifesto. But surely Mr Dorris understands that it is his party in government and that it's the opposition's job to hold government to account to their promises to the people of Scotland on their promises to build £110,000.
Mr Griffin, please resume your seat a second. I'm not really getting to hear Mr Griffin because I've got a whole series of noises off actually involving most benches as far as I can see. Please resume, Mr Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I again say that it's the opposition's job to scrutinise government's promises to the people of Scotland. They promised to deliver 110,000 houses and now are absolutely reneging on that commitment. And Shelter, Homes for Scotland and a whole range of other organisations are clear on what the impact of that will be. Now, in the first months of this year, and what we've seen is that already two builders creating the social homes we desperately need have gone bust in the weeks leading up to this budget. We've got a housing minister apparently in listening mode, but failing to listen to public opinion, where YouGov research today shows that 80% of people think we're in a housing crisis. We've got a housing regulator projecting around 4,500 fewer homes, affordable homes, to be built within the next 5 years. Confirmation that the number of homes starting to be built fell by a quarter and council starts fallen by a half. We've had Homes for Scotland revealing a quarter of all people in Scotland, a quarter, you know, sons, daughters, brothers and sisters, family and friends of everyone in this chamber who have some form of unmet housing need. Presiding Officer, this is a government and a budget planning for decline, for retrenchment, turning its back when the need is so great. It's a government pulling the rug from under the housing sector, council, private and social landlords. They're forcing a downturn which will have dire, dire economic and social consequences. And yet, for all Mr Greer's interventions, the Greens, even though it's a key plank of the Bute House Agreement to hit that £110,000 home target, seem to ignore the reality and even fail to acknowledge that there is a housing emergency out there. Private and affordable housing is interlinked. We have to acknowledge that. For every private home built, that generates £30,000 in economic contributions towards building more social homes alongside the government grant. So the decisions made in this budget will further deter investment in homes across all tenures, sucking life out of the housing market. Presiding officer, first-time buyers, children in temporary accommodation, workers who should be building the homes that we need, our friends and family overcrowded, unable to get out of a private let, stuck on waiting list, every single one of them failed and given up on by this SNP budget. In a general election year where housing will be front and centre, this is a grave miscalculation by a government devoid of an economic strategy, actively planning to send a housing emergency spiralling and has clearly lost its way.
Thank you, Mr Griffin. I call Stuart McMillan to be followed by Ash Regan. Mr McMillan.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. At the outset, the Deputy First Minister, in her opening comments earlier, quoted Rebecca Evans, the Welsh Finance Minister. And I generally think it's actually worth quoting Ms Evans again, because I think after what we've heard this afternoon from colleagues from the Labour Party, they seem to just have kind of one vision that everything is bad in Scotland, but everything in Wales is wonderful. Now, Ms Evans said when she was delivering the draft budget on the 19th of December, and I quote, "After 13 years of austerity, a botched Brexit deal and the ongoing cost of living crisis, this is the toughest financial situation Wales has faced since the start of devolution. Our funding settlement, which comes largely from the UK government, is not enough to reflect the extreme pressures Wales faces." Presiding officer, that is the exact same situation that Scotland faces. This has been a budget debate like most others that I can remember in my near 17 years in this Parliament. The opposition bring forward a list of areas where they want more money to be invested, but once again have got no answers as to where that money should just come from. Now, it's, I mean, Bob Doris just asked Mark Griffin a question a few moments ago, and once again, Mark Griffin, representing the Scottish Labour Party, or the Labour Party in Scotland, did not answer the question. Now, one point I do agree with is that more money should be invested in our public services. Now, the Scottish Fiscal Commission, they estimated that with the change of tax policy in Scotland, that will bring an extra £1.5 billion into the Scottish economy for next year. Now, if this budget is not passed and that's not implemented, then the opposition parties in this Parliament will be voting against that £1.5 billion in addition to the whole budget. So, in effect, they're actually wanting less money into Scotland's economy and less money into the public services in Scotland. I want more money to be invested in local authorities, health, transport, culture, sport and every other devolved area of competence. I also want more money to be invested in the reserve policy areas, but they are obviously outside the realms of this Parliament at the moment. But our public services are under huge pressure after more than a decade of Westminster austerity. Now, the challenge facing the Scottish Government and also the Scottish Parliament is that the powers of this Parliament are limited, and by law that our budget must balance. So if additional resource is to be spent towards local government or health or any other policy area, it needs to come from another budget. And to date, no opposition party has suggested which budgets need to be reduced to give to another. Instead, when I've highlighted why Inverclyde should receive further investment, I've engaged in good faith and frequently suggested where I think some of this money should come from. Presiding officer, I'm not against public sector reform. I think local authorities have already undertaken a great deal of reform, which I welcome. But clearly more reform is required across the whole public sector landscape. And the debate today, though, is about next year's budget, and the most challenging to date under devolution, and with the Scottish budget from Westminster being cut yet again and inflation reducing its value in real terms. Now, I regularly mention my Greenock and Inverclyde constituency in the Chamber as a local MSP. I mean, if I didn't do it, then I'd be accused of not standing up for my constituents. And I often raise issues that affect the whole of Inverclyde, as I did yesterday when I asked the local government minister about extra finance for Inverclyde Council. And I want to thank the Minister for his helpful reply, confirming that Inverclyde Council receives a funding equivalent to £159 per head, which is 6.2% more than the Scottish average, and equates to £12.3 million more overall than it would receive if funded at the Scottish average. And I met the Deputy First Minister on the 14th of December last year and had three key asks for this budget. Increased resources for Police Scotland, increased resources for the Scottish Fire and Rescue Services, and also the Inverclyde Task Force specific request for funding to help deliver the extended Kelbourne Business Park in Port Glasgow due to the demand to go there, and also the specific training assistance to help tackle the long-term unemployed challenge. The Deputy First Minister will be well aware that I have also written separately on the Kelbourne Business Park as request, and I had written to Neil Gray, the Economy Secretary, regarding the employment assistance. The budget before us delivers on my first two requests, which I warmly welcome, and dialogue in the task force items will clearly continue. But after today's bombshell announcement by the BT Group, announcing their intention to close the EE call centre in Greenock later this year and shifting 450 jobs to Glasgow, Inverclyde's situation now becomes even more acute. And with that, I do want to thank the presiding officer for taking my question at First Minister's questions. Now, how the BT Group have handled the situation has been nothing short of appalling, and they must ensure that they properly look after the staff who have been loyal to them over the years. And I'm of the opinion that they have misled their workforce and the Inverclyde community. Consistently, EE would wax lyrical about the future and the job flexibilities they offered, including the wide range of part-time positions, which has helped many women back into the labour market after having families. Now, that will be an additional challenge in Inverclyde, no matter what happens with the budget that we pass in this Parliament. And there more will be said about EE in the Chamber, also, so I'm going to get back to the budget specifically. But this budget is set in turbulent circumstances at the global level. The impacts of inflation, the war in Ukraine and the after effects of the pandemic continue to create instability. And the fiscal also, in addition, the autumn statement delivering the worst-case scenario for Scotland's finances have failed to live up to the challenges posed by the cost of living and also climate crises. Now, the cost of living situation that we face is the most important issue that I face as a constituency MSP. So, presiding officer, in conclusion, this budget is important. No budget is perfect, but ultimately, it's important this budget does pass. But we also know that without the full powers of independence, that our hands are always going to be tied, one hand behind our back, but of course we will be limited because of Westminster austerity. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McMillan. And I now call Ash Regan. Up to 5 minutes, please, Ms. Regan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The brutal choices that the Scottish Government has had to make...
Ms. Regan, could we check that your microphone's in the right position? Thank you.
The brutal choices that the Scottish Government has had to make are a result of a fiscal framework that I warned about a few weeks ago in this chamber that is set up to fail Scotland. And are we really surprised anymore by the callous actions of a UK Tory government that is hostile to people that are struggling to survive with dignity, but can find the money for election promises to keep themselves in power? Tax cuts used cynically and irresponsibly as a sugar rush in an election year, petulantly ignoring warnings of any detrimental consequences, but a refusal to tax obscene wealth, to invest in long-term economic security and environmental responsibility through the reserved fiscal levers that only they have, has a direct and indirect impact on the people of Scotland. While people across the UK continue to suffer from the increasing strain in their cost of living from the UK government's irresponsible choices, here our government is left holding the ball of delivering a pay more, get less budget to constituents across Scotland's communities. But I think people don't want more excuses. In fact, what they're looking for now is solutions. And I do sympathise with the Scottish Government's challenge of spreading an ever-thinning real-term budget across increasing demands. But while election promises are not delivered, it only further erodes public trust. I welcome the Government implementing my proposal for the very necessary short-term step to cancel school meal debt by allocating £1.5 million of funding to local authorities. However, despite the significant cost of living pressure on families, there remains no clarity on the delivery of the government's again delayed commitment of universal access to free school meals for all of Scotland's primary school children. Access to enough and quality food for primary children is a key driver for their development and also for their education outcomes. And this promise must be delivered now without further delay. While the statutory inflationary uplift of £26.70 of the game-changing child payment is welcome, it doesn't go nearly far enough, despite the First Minister himself committing to an increase of £5 in his first budget whilst he was running for party leader. An open letter sent to the First Minister last year was signed by over 150 charities, faith groups, trade unions and civic organisations, urging him to deliver on his commitment as a first step and then to follow up with our ALBA party policy of £40 a week child payment. A must if there is to be any hope at all of the government meeting its targets to tackle the scourge of child poverty in this land of abundant resources. But even such targeted mitigation is not enough, as the Scottish Government is still running to stand still to keep heads above water against the surging consequences of a UK Government choices that Scotland's 59 MPs have no electoral arithmetic to influence at Westminster. I welcome the short-term certainty for households of the council tax freeze, but we need to ensure that local taxation is both fair, affordable and secure, and we need to deliver quality local services that we all rely on. The Government must commit to their long-promised reform of local taxation and do so with real engagement to ensure a solution that works for all. Short-term thinking has got us into a position of cuts and compromise, and only longer-term thinking beyond the walls of devolution can deliver security, confidence and ambition for Scotland. Until then, limited resources need to be stewarded very carefully. And now is not the time to be introducing tax hikes during a cost of living crisis to backfill a budget shortfall. One of the purposes of tax is to create behaviour change. And the behaviour change that these tax rises will usher in, I believe, will be detrimental in the long term to Scotland. I urge the government to end its short-term mindset of cuts and compromise and start to deliver not only on its own election promises, but on the longer-term foundational changes needed to secure us a secure future.
Thank you, Ms Regan. We now move to closing speeches, and I call on Daniel Johnson to close on behalf of Scottish Labour. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And let me attempt to salvage a note of consensus. I think maybe one thing that we can all agree, maybe in line with Stuart McMillan, that this debate has something of a déjà vu feel. And I think we'll probably all feel that we've all gone in and left with exactly the same positions that we left with. And that is maybe a shame. But maybe just let me also reflect on this. If the government wanted a more rational debate, then it needs to be a little bit more transparent with its numbers. This is not a point that I make, but one made by the Finance Committee. Because it's been at pains since the IFS report to stress the need to go budget to budget in its comparisons. But if you were to do that, looking at the entire resource envelope available to the budget, in the budget this year, you'd have 2% more in real terms. Now, I don't think that would be a fair thing to do, because that's not how budgets work. And there are changes that happen in year. But even on those terms, there's 0.9% more to spend in this coming budget year than last. So we need a sense of reality. Now, does that make the choices easy? No, it doesn't. That is a very small increase. But we need to be clear about the choices that have been made. And again, these are understandable. There's been significant pay claims, because again, to strike a note of consensus, the cost of living crisis has to be front and centre. But if you're not clear, if you're not honest about the numbers to begin with, it's very hard to have those conversations. If you're not clear about the choices that have been made on pay settlements and others, you can't have that discussion. And what you're left with is a confused debate that happens at cross purposes. And I think the Finance Committee is exactly right when it states that the budget analysis should include comparison with outturn. A comparison in terms of what the budget proposes to spend with what was actually spent. And then maybe we could have a grown-up conversation, and maybe then we could have a grown-up budget and one that doesn't lead to cuts across so numerous service areas, such as councils. Because despite what the government says, this is a real terms cut. The council tax freeze is not fully funded. That this is going to lead to £130 million less spend. And that is why councils across the land are setting out proposals in their budgets to cut teaching assistants, playgrounds and other vital local services. It's why NHS Lothian are saying that this is now requiring cuts, cutting into the muscle of the services that they deliver. Why they're cancelling projects such as the Eye Pavilion, the National Treatment Centre in St John's and the Cancer Centre at the Western General. And why A&E is running at 30% above its designed capacity in the infirmary. It's why Mark Griffin was absolutely right to point out the absurdity of what's happening in the housing budget, well beyond the decrease to the government's overall capital budget. It's going to see a 26% decrease to the housing budget, which will mean that we will have 1,400 less housing starts in the coming year as compared to before. That's almost a 10% decrease in the housing volumes. I'm very happy to give way to Mr. Swinney.
I'm grateful to Mr. Johnson for giving way, and I understand the aspiration for there to be more spending on the health service. But I think Mr. Johnson, if he wants to engage in a substantive debate with Parliament, has got to explain to us now where is the Labour Party proposing to get the money to address the issues that he's just raised.
Daniel Johnson.
This is not how the process works. The government puts forward a budget. We can't even amend the budget bill. It is for the government to defend its spending. We are scrutinising. These are the consequences of your budget. It is for the government to defend them. And that is why the government needs to defend why it's cutting £28 million from the university budget and why it would have to explain, if it's not 3,900 places that will cut, how much per place is going to cut the students. Now, unless we can have that grown-up conversation, if you can't even put a number of places to that university cut, how can we have a serious debate? Because this is a chaotic budget, as Michael Mara pointed out. A chaotic budget which isn't just about year on year, but about 17 years of these incremental decisions without the long-term thinking, without the long-term plans. And that is exactly why the Finance Committee has been excoriating in its description of the approach. There's a lack of long-term planning, affordability of spending decisions, and the balance between the overall strategic purposes. And indeed, Kenny Gibson went further in his remarks to say that it was lacked strategic or coherence. I hope everyone's okay at the back. Obviously, my speech is having more of an impact than I realised.
Happy to give way.
Briefly, Mr. Gohouse.
Grateful to Daniel Johnson giving way. He's right to say the Finance Committee were excoriating. So too have a chorus of businesses and colleges who've spoken out against the removal of the Flexible Workforce Development Fund, a decision that could crush upskilling needs of 2,000 employers, 45,000 people. Why should they pay the apprenticeship levy if the opportunities aren't going to be forthcoming?
Daniel Johnson.
I think it's a very fair point. And at a time when we ought to be looking about upskilling and reskilling, that is the component of the college's budget that gets cut. I think it flies in the face of the economic realities and why we are absolutely committed to reform of the apprenticeship levy. But ultimately, we need growth. It's only through growth that we will be able to make different changes. But alas, over the last 5 years, Scotland's growth has been almost half that of the UK's. Over 10 years, it's been a third less. And until that point, that's why we are going to continue to get these marginal decisions that increasingly add the burden on those who can barely afford it, why we end up with marginal tax rates of over 60% for people on salaries of £40,000. The people who we ask to work so hard in our public services, nurses, teachers and police officers. And that is why Scottish Labour cannot support the budget this evening at decision time. Thank you very much, Deputy
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. I now call on Murdo Fraser to close on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Up to 7 minutes, please, Mr. Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Graeme Simpson, earlier in the debate, was quoting a Labour Council leader. Now, Labour Council leaders are not always wrong, nor, I should say, is Mr. Simpson. But in this case, he said, this was the worst budget in the history of devolution. And he's right, because I cannot recall any budget over the years I've been in this Parliament, generating such a negative reaction to the one that we're debating today. It's been criticised on all sides. It's been criticised by COSLA, who described it as a major blow to communities, which has put councils at financial risk. It's been criticised by the trade unions, by the universities, by the colleges, by Shelter, which describes it as, describes itself as angered by the extreme cuts announced. It's been criticised by Crisis, the national charity for people experiencing homelessness. It's been criticised by the Federation of Small Business, by ICAS, by the CBI, in a second, by the Scottish Chambers of Commerce, by the Scottish Tourism Alliance, by the UK Hospitality Group, by the Scottish Hospitality Group, by the Scottish Licensed Trade Association, by Scottish Financial Enterprise, by the Scottish Retail Consortium, and so the list goes on. I'll happily give way to anybody on the SNP front bench who can give me a similar list of people who welcemed this budget. And let's hear that from the Finance Secretary.
Murdo Fraser, I think, had the cheek to mention some of the housing organisations and their concerns about the Affordable Housing Supply Programme. Is he really saying that in the light of his government's butchery of our capital budget? Has he really got the nerve to stand up and criticise our spending plans when his government has butchered our capital budget?
Gordon Fraser.
Not one single name of any external body who supports this budget could come from the Finance Secretary, because there isn't one. Every single stakeholder condemned this budget.
On the other point I'll make to the Finance... Mr Fraser, please resume your seat a second. I would say to the front bench to please not act like that. Please listen to the person who has the floor. Mr Fraser, please resume.
On the other point I would make, gently... No, well, come on, I'm still responding to the first intervention, Mr Mason. You'll get your chance in a moment. But the other point I'd make to the Finance Secretary, exactly the same point I made to Mr Stewart, she and her colleagues never recognised the fact that under the Barnett formula, Scotland gets £2,000 more to spend per head of population for every man, woman and child in Scotland compared to the UK average, and she never accepts that point. She should be grateful for the amount of money that is coming from the UK government, far above the UK average. What do they want to do, presiding officer? They want to rip up the Barnett formula. But most damning of all the criticisms, most damning of all is that from the well-respected Institute for Fiscal Studies, who have slammed this budget as giving a misleading impression of the government's spending plans, with this analysis showing that the NHS recovery, health and social care portfolio is actually set to fall in real terms by 0.7%, no increase as has been presented by the Scottish Government. And they say the same in relation to council funding. A purported 6.2% real terms increase falls to 1.8% once actual spending is considered. Now, what we do see from this budget is overall it is up in real terms and cash terms, but right across the portfolios, what do we see are cuts, cuts and more cuts. The housing budget's cut. Core funding to local government is cut. Support for woodland creation is cut. Support for climate change and renewables is cut. The Flexible Workforce Development Fund, much prized by businesses, colleges and trade unions, is scrapped. But perhaps most serious of all is the impact of this budget on business and the economy. So Hamza Yousaf and his administration set out to reset the relationship between the SNP and business. They launched a new deal for business group with that purpose. But this budget rips that to shreds. Yep. Now, if reports are to be believed, Neil Gray has just been reshuffled away from the economy brief. I'll miss my engagement with Mr Gray. I thought he was very good at listening, to the opposition, and very good at listening to business. But fundamentally, he failed, because all the asks that the business community had for this budget, he couldn't deliver on. He lost the argument in Cabinet, and he is left embarrassed in his role. And so we see the calls for the 75% rates relief for retail, hospitality and leisure businesses applicable south of the border to be replicated here in Scotland as dismissed. Instead, we see plans for a new super tax on grocery stores being introduced, making them even less competitive compared to their counterparts down south. Every budget line that could support Scottish business has been cut. The economy, fair work and energy portfolio cut by £118 million, or 8.7% in real terms. The tourism budget cut 12.3%. The Scottish and National Investment Bank cut 29.2%. Enterprise, trade and investment cut 16.7%. And employability cut 24.2%. And it's no surprise against this backdrop that in a survey conducted just within the last 2 weeks of more than 500 members by the Scottish Licensed Trade Association, a staggering 96% said that the Scottish Government did not understand business. I'm sure Neil Gray will be delighted to move away from this portfolio. Yes, I'll give way to Mr.
Swinney.
I'm grateful to Mr. Fraser for giving way. Does he consider that his comments might meet with some more credibility in Parliament if he hadn't been an enthusiastic advocate for the economics of Liz Truss?
Murdo Fraser.
Mr. Swinney has not been keeping up with the data. Perhaps he's deleted the information. If you look at what happened to the UK economy, the UK economy has been the fastest growing of any major European economy since 2010. The UK economy is growing faster than Germany, it's grown faster than France, it's grown faster than Italy. Mr. Swinney, Mr. needs to look at the facts and see how the economy is performing. And we need to remember, he was finance secretary under his watch since 2014. The Scottish economy has grown at precisely one half the rate of the overall UK economy. One half, Mr. Swinney. And as Liz Smith reminded us, if the Scottish economy had grown even at the UK average,
Mr.
we'd have an extra
£6 billion
to spend on public services. Presiding officer, much more I can say, but time is going to run out. People have asked us, what would we do differently? For a start, we'd make different choices. We wouldn't spend £2 billion on a national care service that stakeholders don't want. We wouldn't spend money on pointless papers on independence that nobody's going to read. We wouldn't have wasted £27.6 million on a census that's failed. Millions of pounds wasted on failed court cases. Millions wasted on civil servants to work on an independence referendum that's not going to happen. Millions paid out in compensation for wrongful prosecutions in the Rangers scandal. Millions spent propping up Prestwick Airport and BIFAB. And the hundreds of millions on two ferries that may never yet set sail. What we should have been seeing in this budget, presiding officer, is a budget to grow the economy and grow our tax revenues. This is the worst budget this Parliament has ever seen, and for that reason, we should reject it.
Thank you, Mr. Fraser. And I now call on Shona Robertson, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for Finance, to close on behalf of the Scottish Government. Up to 8 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This, of course, the backdrop to this budget, as many members have said, is a UK autumn statement that has delivered the worst possible scenario for Scotland, a 1.2% real terms cut, a 10% capital. So no, Murdo Fraser, we will not be grateful on these benches for cuts to our public services. And also, of course, Murdo Fraser was very keen to quote Labour Council leaders. Well, it's little surprise, given that the Tories are in coalition with half of them across our local authorities. But coming back to the point about public services, we have prioritised the funding that we do have to our frontline public services, providing over £500 million extra for NHS Scotland, taking total funding for frontline health boards to £13.2 billion next year. A real terms increase, despite a real terms cut to NHS England from the Tories of £1.3 billion. So I won't have Graham Simpson or any other Tory member coming here and criticising this government for our real terms investment in our NHS in Scotland when his government and the Tory government is cutting their own health budget by £1.3 billion. And of course, with only £10.8 million of consequentials derived from health in the autumn statement, we have had to go further in making sure we have put as much money into our frontline health services as we can. And let me come on to education, where we're providing £2.4 billion to support our colleges and universities, including protecting free tuition, driving forward our commitment to widening access. For schools, this budget will deliver £200 million to tackle the poverty-related attainment gap and almost £390 million to protect teacher numbers and fund the teacher pay deal. And on affordable housing, mentioned by a number of people in the Chamber, and of course what's important to recognise in terms of the reduction, the financial transactions element of the reduction is because the financial transactions have gone off a cliff from the UK UK Government. And in terms of our capital, traditional capital funding available, as I've already said, it has been cut. It is the number one priority for me in terms of capital availability if we get more capital at the spring budget on the 6th of March. It was the number one ask I made of the Chief Secretary to the Treasury when I met her 2 weeks ago. I want to come back to the Tories. And let me just look at what Liz Smith and some of her members have said, because the incoherence on the Tory benches is quite astonishing. So on the one hand, Liz Smith said that she would have given £260 million out of the £310 million consequentials for a 75% cut for hospitality. So that's gone from all the other public spending that could have been spent. So let's just log that for a minute. She then said, oh, well, we're going to not spend money on a national care service. Well, that saves £15.4 million in 24-25. Let's throw, for generosity, let's throw the census into that. So that's £50 million. That means that if you take the £260 million and you're generous and say there's another £50 million, there's still about £200 million to find. If you write tax out of that, because the Tories don't want to increase tax, then that's another £100 million. So before we start, in a minute, before we start with all the spending demands from Graham Simpson, Murdo Fraser and the others, they've got £300 million gap to find from public services because they've already spent the money on tax cuts for business. So where is the £300 million going to come from, Liz Smith? I'd like an answer to that.
Liz Smith. I've already set out some other aspects of that, and some of that is in the public sector reform, which the Scottish Government promised in 2016 that it would restore the pre-pandemic levels of things. That's not happened. Can I just ask the Cabinet Secretary if she agrees with our colleague Kate Forbes, who is very anxious about the taxation policies in this budget because she believes it's going to lead to diminishing returns and therefore undermine the growth and the product. It is exactly what she said. Does he agree with that?
Deputy First Minister.
What I acknowledge is that based on the analysis of the Scottish Fiscal Commission, over half of taxpayers will continue to pay less income tax in Scotland than if they lived in the rest of the UK. And the £1.5 billion of additional tax revenues because of the decisions made by successive finance secretaries to make sure that we have money for public finances would also have to be taken out, presumably, of the Tory spending plans if, heaven forfend, they ever bring a budget proposal to this chamber. So now we have about a £2 billion gap in the Tory spending plans. If you take tax out and you take the spending on public services that would now go to NDR business taxes, I think Liz Smith needs to tell us where that £2 billion of cuts in our frontline services presumably would fall. And we should really get an answer from Liz Smith on that in due course, I hope. I want to turn to Labour briefly, because what we heard from Labour was a litany of spending demands, and yet their Welsh Labour colleagues in government, of course, have had to make the same very difficult decisions that we've had, to the extent that really the only area of government that they've increased the funding to is the NHS. Most other departments have had a cut to their funds. All the departments mentioned by Michael Mara and others have all seen cuts to their budget. So therein lies the difference between being in government and being in opposition, where you take responsibility for nothing at all. And if you look at the decisions that Labour are making in opposition, the chaos of ditching policies like the £28 billion of green investment, like now in favour of bankers' bonuses, chaotic U-turns day after day after day. I have no idea what Labour stands for anymore at all. Not a clue. Not one. And of course, it was Daniel Johnson. In a minute, it was Daniel Johnson that just last year called our tax measures. These measures are progressive. Tax is part of the social compact by where those who benefit from public services are asked to contribute and those who have the ability to pay more do so. What happened to Daniel Johnson? Well, of course, we now have Michael Mara, who absolutely has given no idea of the principles that Labour adheres to, but if he wants to now...
Would the Cabinet Secretary recognise that it's her budget that's causing chaos, for instance, in the college sector and university sector, who are having applications coming in and still don't actually know what their budget is? Can she stand up now and tell these parts of the college sector what is their budget going to be for next year?
Deputy First Minister.
I have already said that we are providing over £2.4 billion to support our colleges and our universities, protecting free tuition and driving forward our commitment
to widening access.
I have been clear about our priorities. We have no idea from the Labour benches what your priorities are whatsoever. On Alex Cole-Hamilton and the Liberal Democrats, and this is where it gets to the nub, when they actually do come up with ideas. So the single proposition from Alex Cole-Hamilton was, let me see, tax social media giants. Well, that's really going to help with a budget for 24-25, given we don't even have the powers to tax social media giants. What a great idea! Yeah, good way.
No, I'm afraid, Mr Cole-Hamilton, that the Deputy First Minister must conclude.
That's a shame, because I would really have liked to have heard the answer to that. Perhaps you can write me a wee message, because I'm really curious to know what the answer to that is. I guess, Presiding Officer, it's a bit like Groundhog Day. Year after year, I have listened to the opposition.
Let's hear the Deputy First Minister.
In this place, coming forward with criticisms about the spending priorities of others, with never not one jot of ideas or principles or any suggestions of what they would do different. And that's why we're in government and they're in opposition.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on Budget Scotland No. 3 Bill at Stage 1, and it's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of three Parliamentary Bureau motions. And I ask George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move motions 12102 on committee meeting times, 12103 on committee membership, and 12104 on substitution on committees.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and all moved.
Thank you, Minister. The question on these motions will be put at decision time. And there are two questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that motion 12096, in the name of Shona Robison, on Budget Scotland No. 3, Bill, at Stage 1, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.